Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Baruch Fine and Performing Arts Department suddenly last summer. Please take this time to turn off all cell phones, and please be advised that if you leave the theater during the performance, you will not be able to enter back. And please make sure there are no flashes or photography or video going. Thank you.
Sebastian's garden. The Latin names of the plants were printed on tags attached to them, but the print's fading out. Those plants over there, the largest plants on earth, survivors of the giant fern forests. Of course, in this semi-tropical climate, we have some rare plants, such as the Venus flytrap. You know what that is, Doctor, the Venus flytrap.
An insectivorous plant.
It feeds on insects, yes. Has to go under glass from early fall to late spring. And when it went under glass, my son Sebastian had to provide it with fruit flies, flown in at great expense from a Florida laboratory that did experiments on fruit flies in genetics. Can't do that, Doctor. I just can't do it. It's not the expense, it's
effort.
Yes. So goodbye, Venus flytrap. Like so much else. Well, I don't know why, but I already feel as though I can lean on your shoulder, Dr.
Kukrovitz. It's a Polish word that means sugar. So let's keep it simple and call me Dr. Sugar.
Well now, Dr. Sugar, you've seen Sebastian's garden.
It's like a well-groomed jungle.
That's the way he meant it to be. Nothing was accidental with Sebastian. Everything was planned and designed much like his life and his work.
What was your son's work, Mrs. Venable, besides this garden?
As many times as I had to answer that question. And you know, it still shocks me a little that Sebastian Venable, the poet, is still unknown outside a small coterie of friends, including his mother.
Oh?
You see, strictly speaking, his life was his occupation.
I see.
No, you don't see, Doctor, not yet. Sebastian was a poet. That's what I meant when I said his life is his work, because the work of a poet is the life of a poet, and vice versa. The life of a poet is the work of a poet. I mean, you can't separate them. I mean, well, a salesman's work is one thing, and his life is another, or it can be. Same thing is true of a doctor, lawyer, merchant, thief. Oh, but the work of a poet is the life of a poet. And the life of a poet is the work of a poet in a special sense. Now I just worked myself up all breathless and dizzy. Thank you.
Mrs. Venable, did your doctor okay this thing?
What thing?
You're meeting the girl you think is responsible for your son's death.
I've waited months to face this girl because I didn't get a chance to face her at St. Mary's. I won't collapse. She will collapse. I mean, her lies will collapse, not my truth, not the truth. Forward march, Dr. Sugar. Well, we made it. I didn't know I was so weak on my pins. Sit down, Doctor. I'm not afraid of using every last ounce and inch of my itty-bitty strength and doing just what I'm doing. I'm devoting what's left of my life to the defense of a dead poet's reputation. Now, Sebastian didn't have a public name as a poet. He didn't want one. He refused to have one. He dreaded, abhorred false values, which comes along with fame and personal exploitation. Oh, he would say to me, Violet.
Violet.
Mother.
Mother.
You're going to outlive me.
What would make him think that?
Well, poets are always clairvoyant. Then he had rheumatic fever when he was 15, which affected a heart valve, and he wouldn't get up off of horses and out of the water and so forth. Violet.
Violet.
Mother.
Mother.
You're going to live longer than me. And then, when I'm gone, it'll be yours.
In your hands to do whatever you please with.
Meaning, of course, his future recognition. Now that he did want after his death, so it wouldn't disturb him. Then he did want his work to live on. Have I made my point, Doctor? Well, here it is. My son's work. This is his life living on.
Poem of summer?
Poem of summer. And the date of the summer, there were 25 of them. He wrote one poem a year, printed them out himself on an 18th century hand press from his atelier in the French Quarter, so that no one but he could see it.
He wrote one poem a year?
One for every summer that we traveled together. The other 9 months of the year were merely only a preparation.
9 months?
The length of a pregnancy, yes.
And the poem was hard to deliver?
Yes, even with me. Without me, impossible. He wrote no poem last summer.
He died last summer.
Without me, he died last summer. That was his last summer's poem. One long ago summer, now, why am I thinking about this? My son Sebastian said, Mother!
Listen to this!
He read me Herman Melville's description of the Encantadas, the Galapagos Islands. Quote, take 5 and 20 heaps of cinders, dumped here and there in an outside city lot. Imagine some of them magnified into mountains, the vacant lot, the sea. Then you'll have a fit idea of the general aspect of the Encantadas. Enchanted islands, extinct volcanoes, looking much like the world at large might look at the last conflagration, end quote. Huh. He read that to me and said we just had to go there. So we did go there that summer on a chartered boat, a four-masted schooner, one as close as possible to the one as Melville himself must have sailed on. We saw the Encantadas. But on the incantatas, we saw something that Melville hadn't written about. We saw the giant sea turtles crawl up out of the sea for the annual egg laying. Once a year, the female sea turtle would crawl up out of the equatorial sea onto the blazing sands of a volcanic beach to dig a pit in the sand and deposit her eggs there. It was a long and dreadful thing, the depositing of the eggs in the sand pits. And when it was over, the exhausted female crawled back into the sea, half dead. She never saw her offspring, but we did. Sebastian knew when those eggs would hatch out, and we returned in time to see it.
You went back to the end.
Terrible incantatas, those heaps of extinct volcanoes. Time to witness the hatching of those eggs and their desperate flight to the sea. Along the narrow beach, the color of caviar was all in motion. And the sky was in motion, too.
The sky was in motion, too.
Full of the flesh-eating birds. And the sound of the birds. And the horrible, savage cries.
The carnivorous birds.
Along that dark, narrow beach, where the just-hatched sea turtles were scrambling out of the sea, making their race to the sea.
Race to the sea?
To escape the flesh-eating birds. Which made the sky look almost as black as the beach. And the sands, all alive with the just hatched sea turtles rushing off to the sea while the birds hovered and swooped to attack. They hovered and swooped to attack, diving down on those just hatched sea turtles, turning them over on their underbellies, ripping into their underbellies, and rending and eating their flesh. Sebastian guessed that only 0.01% of their numbers would escape to the sea.
What was it about this spectacle on the beach that fascinated your son?
Well, my son was looking for me. Let's just say he was interested in sea turtles.
That's not what you started to say.
Well, I stopped myself in time.
Say what you started to say.
Well, all right. Now, I started to say that my son was looking for God. I stopped myself because I thought, if I tell you that my son is looking for God, you say to yourself, oh, what a pretentious young crackpot, which Sebastian was not.
Mrs. Venable, doctors look for God, too.
Oh.
Let me tell you something. The first operation I performed at Lion's View, the patient was a young girl, regarded as hopeless, and after the operation, I stayed with the young girl, as if I had delivered a child that might stop breathing. When they finally wheeled her out of surgery, I still stayed with her. It was a nice afternoon, and the moment they wheeled her outside, she whispered something. She whispered, oh, how blue the sky is. And I felt proud because up until then, her speech, everything she had babbled, had been nothing but a torrent of obscenities.
Well, now, I think I can tell you without hesitation that my son was looking for God. And a very clear image of him, too. He spent that whole blazing equatorial day up in the crow's nest of that schooner, watching that thing on the incantatas till it was too dark to see it. And when he came down from that rigging, he said, well, now, I have seen him. And he meant God.
I see.
Little days after that, he came down with a fever. He was delirious with it. I had to take over command of the ship. We went north by east for cooler waters. After that, China, India, into the Himalayas. What? Oh, elixir of the... Isn't it kind of the drugstore to keep me alive? Where was I?
In the Himalayas.
Oh, that long ago summer. Do you know that Sebastian almost joined the Buddhist monastery? Went so far as to shave his head, eat nothing but rice out of wooden bowls sitting on grass mats. He promised those sly Buddhist monk that he give up his world, his worldly possessions, for their mendicant order. Well, I cabled his father, said, for God's sake, notify the bank and freeze Sebastian's accounts. I got a cable back from my late husband's lawyer. Mr. Venable, critically ill, stop. Wants you, stop. Needs you, stop. Immediate return advised most strongly, stop. Cable time of arrival.
Did you go back to your husband?
I made the hardest decision of my life, Doctor. I stayed with my son. And I got him past that crisis, too. In less than a month, he was up off the filthy grass mats, through the bowls in the air, and booked us into Shepherd's Hotel in Cairo. And the Ritz in Paris. Oh, until then, we lived in a world of shadow, light. But the shadow was almost more luminous as the light.
Don't you want to sit down now?
Why, yes, indeed I do, before I fall down. Are your hind legs still on you, Doctor?
My what? Hind legs, yes.
Then you're not a donkey. You're certainly not a donkey, because I just talked the hind legs off a donkey. Several donkeys. But I had to make it clear to you that the world lost a great deal too when I lost my son last summer. You would have liked my son, and he would have been charmed by you. Now, my son Sebastian wasn't a family snob or a money snob, but he was a snob, all right. He was a snob when it came to personal charm in people. Always insisted on having beautiful people around him. Wherever he was, here in New Orleans or in New York City, Venice, Paris, he always had a perfect entourage of the beautiful, the talented, and the young.
Your son was young, Mrs. Venable?
Both of us were young, Doctor. Stayed young, too.
Could I see a photograph of your son?
Why, yes, you can. I'm glad you asked me. Now I'm going to show you not one photograph, but two. Here's my son Sebastian in a Renaissance page boy costume at a mass ball in Cannes. Here he is in the same costume at a mass ball in Venice. Now both of those pictures were taken 20 years apart from each other, Doctor. Which photograph is older?
This photograph looks older.
The photograph looks older. But not the subject. Takes character to refuse to grow old successfully. To refuse to. Takes discipline. Abstention. One cocktail before dinner, not two, four, six. One lean chop and lime juice on a salad at a restaurant famed for rich dishes.
Mrs. Venable, Miss Hobbs' mother and brother.
Hi, I'm Bob.
Violet, dear, we're here.
They're here.
Wait for me in my upstairs living room. Get them upstairs. I don't want them on the porch for this talk. Let's get away from the porch.
Mrs. Venable, did your son have what sort of a personal or a private life?
That's a question I wanted you to ask me.
Why?
Now, I haven't heard the girl's story except for indirectly in a watered-down version, but I gathered enough to know that it's a slander on my son's maw character, which being dead, he can't defend himself. I have to defend him. Now sit down, Doctor, and listen to me. Now before you hear whatever you're gonna hear from this girl this afternoon, my son, Sebastian, was chased. And that's C-H-A-S-E-D. Oh, he was chased by that way of spelling it, too. Let me tell you, we had to be very fleet-footed with his good looks and his charm to stay ahead of his pursuer. I mean C-H-A-S-T-E.
I understood what you meant, Mrs. Fenable. Mm.
And you do believe, you know, what you got?
Yes, but...
But what?
Ooh, chastity, at what age was your son last summer?
Oh, now we really don't count birthdays.
He lived a celibate life?
As if he had vowed to. Now, I know this might sound like vanity, Doctor, but I was the only person in his life that satisfied Sebastian's demands that he had on me. Time after time, he would push people away, dismiss them, because their attitude toward him was
not as pure as
my son Sebastian demanded. We were a famous couple. People didn't talk about Sebastian and his mother or Mrs. Venable and her son. Sebastian and Violet. Violet and Sebastian are staying at the Leader. Sebastian and Violet. Violet and Sebastian have taken a house at Biarritz for the season. Everywhere we appear, attention was centered on us. Everyone else eclipsed. Vanity? Oh, you can't call it that,
Doctor. I didn't call it that.
It wasn't folie de grand jour. It was grand jour.
I see.
An attitude toward life hardly known since the Renaissance princes got crowded out of their palaces and gardens by successful shopkeepers.
I see.
Most people's lives, Doctor, what are they but trails of debris? Long, long trails of debris, more debris, more debris, with nothing to clean it all up, finally, but death. My son Sebastian and I constructed our days, carved out each day like a piece of sculpture. We left ourselves a trail of days like a gallery of sculpture. But not last summer. I can't forgive him, even though he paid for it with his life. He let in this vandal,
the girl that
you're about to meet here this afternoon, yes. He allowed her in, and with her tongue as a hatchet, she went about smashing our legacy, the memory.
Mrs. Venable, what do you think is her reason?
Well, lunatics don't have a reason.
I mean, what do you think is her motive?
What a question. Now, we put the bread in her mouth and the clothes on her back. People who like you for that, or even forgive you for it, or hen's teeth, Doctor. The role of a benefactor is worse than thankless. It's the role of a victim, a sacrificial victim. They want your blood, Doctor. They want your blood on their altar steps of their outraged, outrageous egos.
Oh, you mean she resented the fact that
loathed. They couldn't shut her up at St. Mary's.
I thought she'd been there for months.
Well, they couldn't keep her still there. She babbled. They couldn't shut her up at Cabeza de Lobo. At the clinic in Paris, she babbled, smashing my son's reputation. On the Benigeria, on the way back, she busted out of the stateroom, babbled, even at the airport. When they were flying her back here, she babbled a piece of that story out before they could whisk her away in the ambulance and take her to St. Mary's. This here is a reticule, Doctor. A catch-all, carry-all bag for an old lady, which I turned into last summer. Can you open it for me? My hands are stiff. Fish me out a cigarette and a cigarette holder.
I don't have matches.
I believe there's a table lighter on the table over there.
Yes, there is. My lord, what a torch.
So shines a good deed in a naughty world, Dr. Sugar.
Mrs. Venable?
Yes?
In your letter last week, you made some reference to a fund of
I wrote to you that my lawyers, my bankers, and my certified public accountants are coming up with a Sebastian Venable Foundation Memorial to subsidize young people like you who are pushing out the frontiers of art and science but have a financial problem. You do have a financial problem, don't you, Doctor?
Yes, we do have that problem. Mm-hmm. My work is such a new and radical thing that people in charge of state funds are naturally a little scared of it, and well, they keep us on a small budget. So small that we need a separate ward for my patients. I need trained assistants. I'd like to marry a girl I can't afford to marry, but there's also the problem of getting the right patients, not just criminal psychopaths that the state turns over to us for my operation, because it's, well, risky. I don't want to turn you against my work at Lion's View, but I have to be honest with you. Whenever you enter the brain with a foreign object,
yes,
well, even a needle-thin knife,
yes,
in a skilled surgeon's fingers,
yes,
there's a great deal of risk involved in the operation.
But didn't you say that it pacifies them, quiets them down, makes them peaceful?
Yes, it does that. But that much we already know, but
what?
Well, it will be at least 10 years before we can tell if the immediate benefits of the operation are lasting or passing, or even if there'd still be, and this is what haunts me about it. Any possibility afterwards of reconstructing a totally sound person, it may be that the person will always be limited afterwards, relieved of acute disturbances, but limited, Mrs. Venable.
Oh, but what a blessing to the doctor, to be peaceful, to be just suddenly peaceful. After all the horror and the nightmares, just to be able to lift up their eyes to the sky and see a sky not as black with devouring birds that we saw at the Incantata's, Doctor.
Mrs. Venable, I can't guarantee that a lobotomy would stop her babbling.
That may be. Maybe not. But after the operation, who would believe her, Doctor?
My God. Mrs. Venable, suppose after meeting the girl and observing the girl and hearing the story she babbles, I still shouldn't feel that her condition's intractable enough to justify the risks of... Suppose I shouldn't feel that non-surgical treatments such as insulin shock or electric
shock... She's had all that at St. Mary's now. There's nothing left for her.
But if I disagreed with you...
That's just part of the question, Doctor. Finish the question.
Would you still be interested in my work at Lion's View? I mean, would the Sebastian Venable Memorial Foundation still be interested in it?
Well, aren't we all more interested in a thing that concerns us personally, Doctor?
Oh, Mrs. Venable, you're such an innocent person that it doesn't occur to you. It obviously hasn't even occurred to you that anybody less innocent than you are could possibly interpret this offer of a subsidy as, well, as sort of a bribe.
You can call it that if you want. I don't care. There's only two things to consider here. She's a destroyer, and my son was a creator. Now, if my honesty has shocked you, you can take that little black bag without the subsidy in it and run right out of the garden, Doctor. No one's heard this conversation except for you and me.
Mrs. Venable.
What, Foxy? What is it?
Mrs. Venable, Miss Holly is here.
Oh, my God. There she is at the porch. I told you I didn't want her to enter my house again. I told you to wait at the front door and bring her around the side, but you didn't listen, did you? I can't face her now. I need my 5 o'clock cocktail first to fortify me. Take my chair inside. Doctor? Are you still here? Oh. garden to the other entrance. Doctor? Sugar? You can run into the garden if you wish to. You can run out of the garden if you wish to. You can come this way if you wish to. You can do anything that you wish to, but I need my 5 o'clock daiquiri frozen before I face her.
Sebastian's garden. My God, I can still cry.
Did you have any medication before you went out?
No, I didn't have any. Will you give me some, sister?
Oh, I can't, my dear. I wasn't told to, but I'm sure the doctor will give you something soon.
That young man I bumped into.
Oh, yes, the young doctor's a specialist from another hospital.
What hospital?
A word to the wise is sufficient.
I knew I was being watched. He's behind the curtains, staring out at me. Lies, you! As if they were items on a menu.
Catherine, please.
That one is delicious looking.
Oh, that one is appetizing. Oh, that one is not appetizing. I think it was because he was really nearly half starved from living on pills and salads.
Still, you have to be still now, please.
Oh, he liked me. And so I loved him.
Oh, I know, my dear.
If he'd kept hold of my hand, I could have saved him. Cousin Sebastian suddenly said to me last summer,
let's fly north, little bird. I want to walk under those radiant, cold northern lights.
I have never seen the aurora borealis. Somebody said once, or wrote once, we are all of us children in a vast kindergarten trying to spell God's name with the wrong alphabet blocks. Sister? I think it's me they're calling. Oh.
They call me sister.
Sister.
Behave yourself, Catherine.
Catherine. Dear Catherine. Well, doesn't she look fine, George?
Uh-huh.
Oh, they send you to the beauty parlor whenever you're going to have a family visit. Other times you just look awful. You can't have a compact or lipstick or anything made out of metal because they're afraid you're going to swallow it.
Well, I think she looks just splendid, don't you, George?
Can we talk to her without the nun for me?
Oh, yes, I'm sure it's all right, dear little sister.
Sister Felicity? This is my mother, Mrs. Holly, and my brother George.
Yeah, how do you do?
How do you do?
This is Sister Felicity.
Oh, we are so happy that Catherine's at St. Mary's. So very grateful for all you're doing for her.
We do the best we can for her, Mrs. Holly.
Oh, yes, I'm sure you do. Now, I wonder if you would mind if we had a private chat with our Catherine.
Oh, no, you see, I'm not supposed to let her out of my sight.
Oh, just for a minute. You can wait out in the hall or the garden, and we'll call you right back the minute the private part of our chat's over.
All right. Excuse me.
Jesus, what are you up to? Our sister, are you trying to ruin us?
George, will you be quiet? You're upsetting your sister.
How elegant George looks.
Yes, George inherited Cousin Sebastian's wardrobe, but everything else is in probate. Did you know that? And everything else is in probate, and Violet can keep it in probate just as long as she wants to.
Where is Aunt Violet?
George, get back here! Violet's on her way down.
And Violet has an elevator now.
Yes, she has. And sister, it is the cutest little thing you ever did see. It's paneled in Chinese lacquer, black and gold Chinese lacquer with lovely bird pictures on it. But there's only room for two at a time on it, and George and I had to come down on foot. I think she's having a frozen daiquiri now. She still has a frozen daiquiri every afternoon in the world in warm weather. Sister, the horrible death of Sebastian just about killed her. She's slightly better now, but it's a question of time. Dear, I'm sure you know. You understand why we haven't been out to see you at St. Mary's. They said you were too disturbed, and a family visit might disturb you more, but I want you to know that nobody, absolutely nobody, knows a thing you've been through. Have they, George? Not a thing. Not even a soul knows you've come back from Europe. When people inquire, when they question us about you, we just tell them you've stayed abroad to study one thing or another. Sister, I want you to be very careful about what you tell your Aunt Violet happened in Cabeza de Lobo.
What do you want me to say about what happened?
Just don't repeat that same fantastic story. For my sake and for George's sake, for the sake of your brother and your mother, just don't repeat that horrible story again, not to Violet, will you?
Well, then I am going to have to tell Aunt Violet what happened to her son in Commandant in Lobo last summer.
Honey, that's why you're here. She's insisted on hearing it straight from you.
You were the only witness to it, Kathy.
No, there were others that ran.
Sister, you've just had a little sort of a nightmare about it. Listen to me, will you, sister? Sebastian has left, has bequeathed to you and George in his will.
To each of us, 50 grand each. After taxes. Get it?
Yes, but if they give me the injection, I won't have any choice but to tell exactly what happened to Cousin Sebastian incubated in Lobo last summer. Oh, don't you see? I won't have any choice but to tell the truth. And it makes you tell the truth because it shuts someone off that might make you able not to, and everything comes out decent or not decent, and you have no control but always, always the truth.
Catherine! Darling. I don't know the full story, but surely you're not too sick in your head to know in your heart that this story you've been telling, it's just too...
Kathy, you've got to forget that story, can't you? For your 50 grand.
Because if Aunt Vi contests the will, we know she'll contest that she'll keep in the courts forever.
It's in probate now, and it'll never get out of probate until you agree to drop that story. We can't afford to hire lawyers good enough to contest it. So if you don't agree to stop telling that crazy story about what you say happened to Cousin Sebastian and Cabezan de Lobo, we won't have a pot to cook greens in.
Catherine, don't laugh like that. It scares me, Catherine.
Kath, the money is all tied up. If Aunt Vi decided to contest Sebastian's will, that leaves us all of this cash. I'm not coming through to you.
Oh, yes, little brother, you are.
You see, Mama, she's crazy like a coyote. We won't get a single damn penny. Honest to God, we won't. So you've just got to stop telling that story about what you say happened to Cousin Sebastian in Cabeza de Lobo, even if it's what it couldn't be. True. You've got to drop it, sister. You can't tell such a story to civilized people in a civilized up-to-date country.
Kathy, why did you invent such a tale?
But Mother, I didn't invent it. No, it's a hideous story, but it's a true story of our time and the world we live in, and what truly did happen to Cousin Sebastian in Cabeza de Lobo.
Then you are going to tell it. Mama, she is going to tell it right to Aunt Vi and lose us 100,000. Kathy, you are a bitch.
George!
I'll repeat it, a bitch. She isn't crazy, Mama. She's no more crazy than I am. She's just perverse.
No.
Was always perverse.
George! George! Apologize to your sister. There is no way for you to speak to your sister.
You come right back over here and you tell your sweet little sister you're sorry you spoke up after her.
I'm sorry, Kathy. You know we need that money. Mama and me. We, Kathy. I got ambitions and Kathy, I'm young. I want things. I need them, Kathy. So will you please, just think about me, us.
Mrs. Holland, Mrs. Holland.
Somebody's calling for me. Catherine, George put it very badly, but you know it's true. We do have to get what Sebastian has left us in his will, and you won't let us down. Promise, dearest, you won't let us down. Catherine.
Here comes Aunt Violet. Mama, Kathy, Aunt Violet. Here's Aunt Vi.
Kathy!
Here's Aunt Vi!
Well, she sees me and I see her. And that's all that's necessary. Fox Hill put me in the corner over here. Crank her back up a little. More. More! Not that much. Bring it back down a little bit. All right. I'll have my 5 o'clock daiquiri, and if you all want coffee.
I'd like a chocolate malt.
George?
It's not a drugstore.
Oh, George is just being George.
That's what I thought he was being. this translation now. It's in a separate...
Separate, yes, here it is.
Uh-huh.
And here's the report of the private investigators.
Yes. Where's the doctor?
On the phone in the library.
Why does he choose a time such as now to make a phone call?
He didn't make a phone call. He received a phone
call. Fox Hill, why are you talking to me like a burglar?
And Violet, she's frightened. I can't move. Can I get up and move around till it starts?
Kathy, did George tell you that he received beads from every good fraternity on the Tulane campus and went Fidel because Paul Jr. did?
I see that he had the natural tact and fine taste to come here this afternoon outfitted, head to foot, in my son Sebastian's clothing.
You gave him to me, Advi.
Didn't expect you parade them around on me, George.
George, tell Aunt Violet how grateful you are.
I found a little Jew tailor on Britannia Street that makes alterations so good, you never guess they won't cut off me to begin with.
And so reasonable. Luckily, since Sebastian's wonderful bequest to George and Kathy is gonna be tied up a while.
And by about the weird, I was just wondering if we couldn't find some way to...
George means to expedite it, to get it through the red tape quicker.
I understand his meaning. Fox, he'll get the doctor.
Doctor!
George, know more about money.
We know we'll never see her again.
What's wrong, dear?
I think I'm just dreaming. This doesn't seem real.
He had to answer an urgent call from Limesville.
Violet, not Limesville.
Wait, dear.
What for? I know what's coming.
Why? You have $1,000 a month plus extra charges for treatments to keep this one in St. Mary's?
Kathy, tell Aunt Violet how grateful you are for making it possible for you to rest and recuperate in such a sweet, sweet place as St. Mary's.
No place for lunatics is a sweet, sweet place.
But the food's good there, isn't the food good there?
Just give me written permission not to eat fried grits. I had yacht privileges, so I refused to eat fried grits.
Actually, she lost yacht privileges because she couldn't be trusted alone even with supervision of the yacht because she'd run out to the fence and make signs to the cars on the highway.
Yes, I did. I did that because I've been trying for weeks to get a message out of that sweet, sweet place.
What message, dear?
Oh, I got panicky, mother.
Sister, I don't understand.
What are you scared of, sister?
What they might do to me now after they've done all the rest. That man behind the curtain is a specialist in Lion's View. We get newspapers. I know what they're...
Doctor. I thought you left us with just that little black bag to remember you by.
Oh, no, don't you remember our talk?
This is Dr. Kukrovitz. He says it means sugar, and we can call him Sugar. He's a specialist at Lion's View.
What does he specialize in?
Something new when all other treatments have failed.
Do you want to bore a hole in my skull and turn a knife in my brain? Everything else was done to me. You'd have to have my mother's permission for that.
I pay to keep you in a private asylum.
You're not my legal guardian.
I'm responsible for her, all of you, financially.
I think the situation is clear.
Good in that case.
I think a quiet atmosphere will get us the best results.
I don't know what you mean by quiet atmosphere. She shouted. I didn't.
Mrs. Venable, let's try to keep things on a quiet level now. Your niece seems to be disturbed.
She has every reason to be. She tried to take my son away from me.
Aunt Violet, you're not being fair.
Oh, aren't I?
Yes, she's not being fair. Aunt Violet, you know why Sebastian asked you to travel.
Yes, I know why.
You weren't able to travel. You had a...
Go on. What had I had? You afraid to say it in front of the doctor? She means to say that I had a stroke. I did not have a stroke. It was a slight aneurysm. You know what that is, Doctor. Not a hemorrhage. Just a slight vascular convulsion of a blood vessel. I had it when I found out that she was trying to take my son away from me. That's when I had it. Left me with a temporary muscular contraction on one side of my face. These are not my blood relatives, Doctor. My dead husband's relations. Ah! Always hated these people. My dead husband's sister and her two worthless children. But I did more than my duty to keep their head above water to please my son, whose weakness was being soft-hearted. I went through the expense and humiliation, public humiliation, to give this girl a debut, which was a fiasco. No one liked her when I brought her out. Oh, she had some kind of notoriety. She had a sharp tongue that some people mistook for wit. Had the habit of laughing in the faces of decent people, which irritated them and reflected adversely on me and my son Sebastian, too. But my son was amused by this girl. While I was sickened, disgusted, and halfway through the season, she was dropped off the party list, just dropped off the list in spite of my position. Why? Because she lost her head over a young married man, made a scandalous scene at a Mardi Gras ball right in the middle of the ballroom. Then everybody dropped her like a hot rock. But my son Sebastian still felt sorry for her and took her with him instead of me last summer.
I can't change truth. I'm not God. I don't think that he could.
She was in love with my son.
Let me go back to St. Mary's.
You're not going back there.
All right, lied to you then, but don't ask
you. You know that you were.
There was what, Aunt Violet?
Don't you call me aunt. You are my dead husband.
Catherine, don't upset you. Doctor,
I don't want to. I didn't want to come here. I know what she thinks. She thinks I murdered her son. She thinks I'm responsible for his death.
That's right. I told him when he told me he was taking you last summer instead of me that I would never see him again. And I never did. And only you know why.
Oh, my God.
Miss Catherine.
What?
I'd like to be left alone with Miss Catherine for a few minutes.
And by Kathy can't go to Lionsview. Everyone in the Garden District would know that you put your niece in a state asylum, and by
Fox Hill.
What do you want, and by?
Let go of my chair! Fox Hill, get me away from these people.
Hey, Bob, listen, think of the
time. I can't get up. Push me away.
I'll push you, Miss Fox Hill.
Let go of my chair, Rob.
Holly,
I gotta talk to her.
Fox Hill.
Mr. Holly, she doesn't want you to push her.
I know what I'm doing. Leave me alone with Aunt Bob.
Let me go or I'll strike you.
Oh, Aunt Bob. Oh.
George.
Aunt Bob.
Is a very sick woman. She had a stroke last spring.
Yes, she did. She'll never admit to it.
You have to understand why.
Do you understand why? I didn't want to come here.
Miss Catherine, do you hate her?
I don't understand what hate is. How can you hate anybody and still be sane? You see, I still think that I'm sane.
You think she did have a stroke?
She had a slight stroke in April. It just affected her one side, the left side of her face, but it was disfiguring. And after that, Sebastian couldn't use her.
Use her? Did you say use her?
Yes. We all use each other, and that's what we think of as love, and not being able to use each other is what's hate.
Do you hate her, Miss Catherine?
Didn't you ask me that once? And didn't I say that I didn't understand what hate is? A ship struck an iceberg at sea. Everyone sinking.
Go on, Miss Catherine.
But that's no reason for everyone drowning, for hating everyone drowning, is it, Doctor?
Tell me, what was your feeling for your cousin, Sebastian?
He liked me. And so I loved him.
In what way did you love him?
The only way he'd accept, or sort of a motherly kind of way. I tried to save him, Doctor.
From what?
No.
Save him from what?
The completing this sort of image he had of himself as a sort of sacrifice to this terrible sort of a...
God?
Yes, he's a cruel one, Doctor.
How did you feel about that?
Doctor, my feelings, or the sort of feelings that you have in a dream.
Your life doesn't seem real to you.
Suddenly last winter, I began to write my journal in the third person.
Something happened last winter?
At a Mardi Gras ball, some boy that took me to it got too drunk to stand up. Well, I wanted to go home. My coat was in the cloakroom, and they couldn't find the check for it in his pockets, so I said, oh, hell, let it go. I started out for a taxi, but somebody took my arm and said, I'll drive you home. He took off his coat as you left the hotel and put it over my shoulders, and then I looked at him, and I don't think I've ever even seen him before then, really. He took me home, but he took me to another place first. We stopped near the Doolin Oaks at the end of Esplanade Street. Stopped, I said. What for? Oh, he didn't say anything. He just struck a match in the car to light a cigarette in the car. And I looked at him in the car and... well, I knew what for. And I think I got out of the car before he got out of the car. And we rushed through that wet grass to the great misty oaks as if somebody was calling us for help there.
After that?
I lost him. He took me home and said an awful thing to me. We'd better forget it. He said, my wife's expecting a child, and oh, I just entered the house and sat there thinking a little, and then I suddenly called a taxi, and I went right back to that Roosevelt Hotel ballroom. The ball was still going on, and well, I thought I had gone back to pick up my borrowed coat, but that wasn't what I had gone back for. No, I had gone back to make a scene on the floor of the ballrooms. Yes, I didn't stop to pick up Aunt Violet's old mink stole. No, I rushed right into that ballroom, and I spotted him on the floor, and I ran up to him, and I beat him as hard as I could in the face, in the chest, in my fist, till... Oh. So Cousin Sebastian took me away. Well, it was after that, the next morning, I started writing my diary in the third person, singular, such as, she's still living this morning, meaning that I was. What's next for her, God knows. Well, I couldn't go out anymore for that. And then, one morning, Cousin Sebastian came into my bedroom and said,
Get up!
Well, if you're still alive after the dying, then you're obedient, Doctor. I got up. He took me downtown to a place for passport photos, said, Mother can't go abroad with me this summer. You're going to go with me instead of Mother. If you don't believe me, I'll read my journal of Paris. She woke up at daybreak this morning, had a coffee, got dressed, and took a brief walk.
Who did?
She did. I mean, I did. From the hotel Plaza Athenae to the Place de la Toise, were pursued by a pack of Siberian wolves. Didn't stop for stop signs. Couldn't wait for green signals. Where did she think she was going? Back to the Doolin Oaks. Everything chilly and dim, but his heart ravenous mouth.
Miss Catherine. Let me give you something.
Do I have to have the injection again? Well, what am I going to be stuck with this time, Doctor? I don't care. I've been stuck so often that if you connected me to garden hose, I'd make a good sprinkler.
Please take off your jacket.
I didn't feel it.
That's good. Now sit down.
Shall I start counting backwards from 100?
Do you like counting backwards?
Oh, love it. Just love it. 100, 99, 98, 97, 96, 95. Oh, I already feel it. How funny.
That's right. Close your eyes for a minute. Miss Catherine, I want you to give me something.
Name it, and it's yours, Dr. Sherman.
Give me all your resistance.
A resistance to what?
The truth, which you are going to tell me.
The truth's the one thing I've never resisted.
Sometimes people just think they don't resist it, but still do.
They say it's at the bottom of a bottomless well, you know.
Relax.
True.
Don't talk.
Where was I? At 90.
You don't have to count backwards.
At 90 something.
You can open your eyes.
I do feel funny. Do you know what I think you're doing to me? Well, I think you're trying to hypnotize me. You're looking so straight at me and doing something with your eyes and your eyes. Is that what you're doing to me?
Is that what you feel I'm doing?
Yes, I feel so peculiar, and it's not just the drug.
Give me all your resistance. See, I'm holding my hand out. I want you to put yours in mine, and give me all your resistance. Pass all of your resistance out of your hand to mine.
Well, here's my hand. There's no resistance in it.
You are totally passive.
Yes, I am.
You will do as I ask.
Yes, I will try.
You will tell the true story.
Yes, I will.
The absolutely true story. No lies, nothing not spoken. Everything told, exactly.
Everything, exactly. Because I'll have to. Can I stand up?
Yes, but be careful. You might feel a little bit dizzy.
make it up. Tell me to. Then I think I could do it.
Stand up.
How funny. And now I can't. I do feel a bit dizzy. I'm about to fall over.
You see, you lost your balance.
No, I didn't. I did what I wanted to do without you telling me to. Let me. Oh, no, please, hold me. I've been so lonely. It's lonelier than death. If I've gone mad, it's lonelier than death.
Kathy, you've got a hell of a nerve.
What's the matter, George? Is Catherine ill?
No. Miss Catherine had an injection that made her a little unsteady.
What do you say about Catherine?
She's gone into the garden.
That's all right, sister. She'll come back when I call her.
It may be all right for you. You're not responsible for her.
Call her now.
Miss Catherine, come back. Bring her back, please, sister. Right. Catherine, you're going to tell the true story.
Where do I start the story?
Wherever you think it started.
I think it started the day he was born in this house.
Yeah, now you see.
Kathy.
Let's start later than that.
Come on, I'm right here. Come on.
Shall we begin with last summer?
Oh, last summer.
Yes, last summer.
Could I,
keep that boy away from her.
She wants to smoke and buy.
Something helps in the hands.
No.
It's all right, sister. Last summer, how did it begin?
It began with his kindness and the 6 days at sea that took me so far from the Doolin Oaks that I forgot it nearly. He was affectionate with me, so sweet and attentive that, or some people took us for a honeymoon couple, so they noticed that we had separate staterooms. Oh, and then in Paris, he took me to Patou and Schiaparelli's and, oh, this is from Schiaparelli's. Bought me so many new clothes, I had to give away my old ones to make room for my new ones and my new luggage to travel. Well, I turned into a peacock. Of course, so was he one too.
Shh.
But then I made the mistake of responding too much to his kindness, of holding on to his hand before he'd take hold of mine, of holding on to his arm and leaning on his shoulder, of appreciating his kindness more than he wanted me to. And then, suddenly last summer, he began to be restless and, oh!
Go on, Miss Catherine.
The Blue Jay notebook.
Did you say notebook?
I know what she means by that. She's talking about that school composition book with the Blue Jay trademark on it that Sebastian had for his notes and revisions of Poem of Summer. It went with him everywhere he went, in his dinner jacket pocket. I have the one that he had last summer. Fox Hill, the Blue Jay notebook. Can't came back on the ship from Cabeza de Lobo with his personal effects.
I don't quite get the connection between new clothes and so forth.
Here it is, Dr. Teller, I found.
With all these interruptions.
This is important now. I don't know why she brought up the Blue Jay notebook, but I want you to read it. Here it is. Title, Home of Summer. Year, 1935. After that, what? Blank pages. Blank pages. Nothing but nothing last summer.
What's that got to do with...
his destruction? Well, I'll tell you. Now, a poet's vocation is something that rests on something as thin and as fine as a spider's web, Doctor. It's the only thing he had to hold him over out of destruction. Great help is needed. I gave it, she didn't.
She's right about that. I failed him. I couldn't keep the web from breaking. I saw it breaking, but I couldn't save it or repair it.
Now the truth is coming out. We had an agreement, a contract, sort of a covenant that he broke last summer when he took her with him instead of me. When he was frightened and I knew why and what for, because his hands would start shaking and his eyes would turn in and not out. So I would put my hand across the table, place my hand on his hands without a word, just a look. Just my hand on his hands until his hands stopped shaking and his eyes looked out and not in. Next morning, the poem would be continued. Continued until it was finished.
I couldn't.
Naturally not. He was mine. I knew how to help him. I did. You didn't. You couldn't.
These interruptions are...
I said you will, and he would. I said...
Yes. Yes, you see, I failed him. And we went to Cabeza Lobo. We gave up writing his poem last summer.
Because he had said that with the...
Yes, yes. Somebody had broken that string of pearls the old mothers hold their sons
she
by.
She means so I held him back from his...
That Sebastian wasn't young anymore. And we went to Cabeza Lobo, and he suddenly switched from the evenings to the beach.
From evenings to beach?
I mean, from the evenings, the afternoons, and from the
fashionable. Is that the word?
Yes, yes. Suddenly last summer, Cousin Sebastian changed to the afternoons and the beach.
What beach?
In Cabeza de Lobo, there's a beach that's named for Sebastian's namesake. It's known as La Playa San Sebastian. And that's where we started spending all afternoon every day.
What kind of a beach was it?
It was a big city beach near the harbor.
It was a big public beach.
Yes, public.
It's statements like that that gives her away. After all I told you about his fastidiousness, that you would accept a statement like that?
You mustn't interrupt.
That Sebastian Venable would be around a dirty, filthy, free beach near a harbor? A man who had to take a boat a mile out to find water fit enough to swim.
Mrs. Venable. No matter what she says, you have to let her say it without any more interruptions, or this interview will be useless.
Well, I won't say another word. I'll keep still if it kills me.
I don't want to go on.
Go on with the story, Miss Catherine. Every afternoon, last summer, your cousin Sebastian and you went to this free public beach?
No. It wasn't the free one. The free one was right next to it. There was a fence in between the free one and the one that we went to that charged a small charge of admission.
Yes, and what did you do there? Did anything happen there that disturbed you about it?
Well, yes.
What?
He bought me a swimsuit I didn't want to wear. Well, I laughed. I said, well, I can't wear that. It's a scandal to the Jaybirds.
What did you mean by that? That the suit was immodest?
Oh, my God, yes. It was a one-piece swimsuit made of white lye. The water made it transparent. Well, I didn't want to swim in it, but he grabbed my hand and dragged me in the water all the way in, and I'd come out looking naked.
Why did he do that? Did you understand why?
Yes, to attract attention.
He wanted to attract attention, did he? Because he felt you were moody? Lonely. He wanted to shock you out of your depression last summer.
Don't you understand? I was procuring for him! Oh, she used to do it too! And not consciously, she didn't know that she was procuring for him in the smart, the fashionable place I used to go to before last summer. Sebastian was shy with people. She wasn't, neither was I. We both did the same thing for him, made contacts for him, but well, she did it in the nice places and in decent ways, and I had to do it in the way that I just told you. Oh, Sebastian was lonely, Doctor. And that big, empty blue chain notebook got bigger and bigger, as big and empty as that big and empty blue sea and sky. And I knew what I was doing. I came out in the French Quarter years before I came out in the Garden District.
Kathy's sister.
Hush!
And before long, when the weather got warmer and the beach so crowded, he didn't need me anymore for that purpose. The ones in the free beach began to climb over the fence or swim around it. Bands of homeless young people that had lived on the free beach like scavenger dogs or hungry children. So now he let me wear the decent dock suit. And I'd go to a faraway empty end of the beach to write postcards and letters and keep up my third person diary till it was 5 o'clock in time to meet my side, the bathhouses on the street. He would come out followed.
Who would follow him out?
The bands of homeless young people that had climbed over the fence from the free beach that they lived on. Oh, he'd pass out tips amongst them as if they had all shined his shoes or called him a taxi. And each day the crowd got bigger, noisier, greedier, and at last we stopped going out there.
And then? After that? After you quit going out to the public beach?
After that, a few days after we stopped going out to the beach, it was one of those blazing white days in Cabeza de Lobo. Not a blazing hot blue one, but a blazing hot white one.
Yes?
We had a late lunch at one of those open air restaurants along the harbor there. Oh, Sebastian was white as the weather. He had on a white silk shantung suit and a white silk tie and a white Panama and white shoes and white lizard skin pumps. he kept touching his face and his throat here and there with a white silk handkerchief and popping little white pills in his mouth. And that was how I knew he was having a bad time with his heart and was frightened by it. And that was the reason we had stopped going out to the beach.
I think we ought to go north,
he kept saying. I think we've done Cabeza de Lobo. I think we've done it.
Don't you?
Well, I thought we'd done it. But I had learned it was better not to seem to have an opinion because, well, if I did, well, Sebastian, well, you know Sebastian, he always preferred to do what no one else wanted to do. And I would try to give the impression that I was agreeing reluctantly to his wishes. It was a game. She's dropped a cigarette.
I've got it, sister.
Where was I? Oh, yes, that 5 o'clock lunch at one of those fish places along the harbor. It was between the city and the sea, and there were naked children along the beach, which was fenced off with a barbed wire from the restaurant. And we had a table less than a yard away from that barbed wire fence which held the beggars at bay. There were naked children along the beach, a band of frightfully thin, dark naked children, and they would all come darting up to this barbed wire fence as if blown there by a hot wind, a hot white wind from the sea, all crying out, pan, pan, pan.
What's pan?
The word for bread, and they make goblin noises with their little black mouths and stuffing little black fists to the mouths and making goblin noises with frightful grins. Of course, we were sorry we had gone out there, but it was too late to go.
Why was it too late to go?
I told you, Cousin Sebastian wasn't well. He kept popping those little white pills in his mouth. I think he had popped in so many of them, they had made him feel weak. His eyes looked dazed, but he said,
don't you look at those little monsters.
Beggars are a social disease in this country. If you look at them, you get sick of the country. It spoils the whole country for you.
Go on.
I'm going on. I have to wait now and then till it gets clear under the jug. It has to be a vision or nothing comes.
All right.
Always when I was with him, I did what he told me. I didn't look at the band of naked children. Not even when the waiters drove them away from that barbed wire fence with sticks rushing out through that wicket gate like an assault party in war and beating them, screaming them away from the barbed wire fence with sticks. Then...
Go on, Miss Catherine. What comes next in the vision?
The band of naked children began to serenade us.
Do what?
Play for us. On instruments, make music, if you could call it music.
Oh?
Their instruments were instruments of a percussion. Do you know what I mean?
Yes, instruments of percussion, such as drums.
So glances at them when Cousin Sebastian wasn't looking, and as far as I could tell in that white heart of the sand beach, their instruments were tin cans strung together.
Tin cans strung together?
And bits of metal, other bits of metal that had been flattened out and made into
what?
Symbols. You know, symbols.
Yes, brass plates hit together.
That's right, Doctor. Tin cans flattened out and clashed together. Symbols.
Yes, I understand that. What's after that in the vision?
Oh, and others had paper bags made out of coarse paper with a sort of a string on the inside which they put up and down and back and forth to make up sort of a...
Sort of a...
Noise like? Oompa, oompa, oompa.
Ah, sound like a tuba.
Oh, that's right, Dad. A sound like a tuba.
Oompa, 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 like a tuba.
Oompa, 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 like a...
Tuba.
During lunch, they stayed at a fairly close distance.
Go on with the vision, Miss Catherine.
No, I'm going on. Nothing could stop it now.
Your cousin Sebastian was entertained by this concert?
I think he was. He was terrified of it.
Why was he terrified of it?
I think he recognized some of the musicians, some of the boys, between childhood and older.
What did he do? Did he do anything about it, Miss Catherine? Did he complain to the manager about it?
What manager? God? Oh, no, you mean the manager at the fish place of the market? No. No, you don't understand my cousin.
What do you mean?
He accepted all as how things are and thought nobody had any right to complain or interfere in any way whatsoever. And although he knew that what was awful, that what was wrong, and my cousin Sebastian was certainly never sure that anything was wrong, he thought it unfitting to ever take any action against anything whatsoever, except to go on doing as something in him directed.
What did something in him direct him to do? I mean, on this occasion, in Cabeza de Lobo.
After the salad, before they bought the coffee, he suddenly pushed himself away from the table and said,
they've got to stop that! Waiter! Make them stop that! I'm not a well man! I have a heart condition! It's making me sick!
Oh, this was the first time that Sebastian ever attempted to correct a human situation. I think perhaps that was his fatal error. It was then that the waiters, all 8 or 10 of them, are charged out of the wicket gate, beating the leading musicians away with clubs or skillets or anything hard they could find from the kitchen. Now, Cousin Sebastian had left the table. He stalked out of the restaurant after throwing a handful of a pip of money into the table, and he fled from the place. Well, I followed. It was all white outside, a hot, blazing white, at 5 o'clock in the afternoon in the city of Cabeza de Lobo. It looked as if? As if a huge white bone had caught on fire in the sky and blazed so bright. It was white and turned the sky and everything under the sky white with it.
White?
Yes, white.
You followed your cousin Sebastian out onto this hot white street?
Running up and downhill.
You ran up and downhill?
No, we didn't move, by the way, because at first we were, I rarely made any suggestions, but this time I did.
What did you suggest?
Well, Sebastian seemed to be paralyzed near the entrance of the cafe, so I said, let's go. I remember it was a very wide and steep white street, and I said, well, cut Sebastian down that way is a waterfront, and we are more likely to find a taxi near there. Or when we go back in, now the waiters call us a taxi. Oh, let's do that, that's better. But he said,
man, are you mad? Go back to that filthy place, never! That gang of kids shouting vile things about me to the waiters!
Oh, I said, well then, let's go down toward the docks. I'm there at the bottom of the hill. Let's not try to climb the hill in this dreadful heat, because the bash
and shouted,
"Please just shut up and let me handle this situation, will ya? I want to handle this thing!"
And he started up that steep street with a hand stuck in his jacket, where I knew he was having a pain in his chest from his palpitations. He walked faster and faster and panicked. But well, the faster he walked, the louder and closer it got.
What got louder?
Oh, the music!
The music again!
Oompa Oompa, the fallen bands, they somehow got into that barbed wire wicket gate. And they were following, pursuing us up the blazing white street in the sun. Those that break my bone, which I beat, they're caught on fire in the sky. Oh, Sebastian started to run, and they all screamed at once and seemed to fly in the air. They outran him so quickly. I screamed. I heard Sebastian scream. He screamed just once before this flock of black plucked little birds overtook him halfway up that white hill.
And you, Miss Catherine, what did you do then?
I ran.
You ran where?
Down. Oh, the easier direction to run was down the blazing street, screaming up the hill all the way.
What?
Waiters, police, and others, ran out of the buildings and rushed back up the hill with me. When we got back to where my cousin Sebastian had disappeared in the flock of featherless little black sparrows, lying naked, as they had been naked, against a white wall. And this you won't believe. Nobody has believed it. Nobody could believe it. Nobody on earth could possibly believe it, and I don't blame them. They had devoured him. Torn or cut parts of him away with their hands, or knives, or maybe those jagged tin cans they had made music with. They had torn bits of him away and stuffed him into those gobbling, fierce little empty black mouths of theirs. There wasn't a sound anymore. There was nothing to see but Sebastian, what was left of him. That looked like a big, white, paper-wrapped bunch of red roses had been torn, thrown, crushed against that blazing white wall.
I'll get a job.
Hush, son. Doctor, can't you say something?
I think we ought at least to consider the possibility that the girl's story could be true.
Thank you.